Well, good morning. Welcome to church this morning, everybody. It's so good to have you here. It's so good to see everybody online. We'll get you guys to stand up. Let's worship together. It's going to be good.
Here with us this morning, anyone watching online, thank you for joining us. It's exciting to know that when we gather and we praise the Lord, wonderful things happen. And if you're here this morning, I just encourage you to have freedom to do that, to sing. We have music that's loud so no one can hear you. So just sing as loud as you can. That's what I'm doing, standing right by that speaker there. Singing as loud as I can because it's been so good to worship together with one another. So this week we have Tuesday, Thursdays, as per usual. So tune in online for that. Bronson will be putting the tithe information up for you if you are at home and you would like to donate this morning. If you're here this morning and you want to use the debit, just make sure you use the hand sanitizer before. And the little burgundy basket is where you'd put your offering. Thank you for that. The prayer email, nb4square@gmail.com, is still going. So if you have prayer requests, if you know of anyone, let them know. That email is there, and someone is checking it, and we are praying for those requests. Also, a reminder to head to YouTube and hit subscribe to our channel page.
I don't know.
That's whatever YouTube is. .com. Look it up.
YouTube.com.
You'll find us there. Also, we are on the Access channel. I think they'll be broadcasting some older services. So if you know someone who has access to that, but maybe not YouTube or Facebook, let them know, and they can tune in to our services there. Again, just a reminder, let's have freedom in this place this morning. Let's worship the Lord, and let's glorify Him.
Yes, that's right. Thanks, Levi. What a good job on announcements. Everybody clap your hands for Levi. Wasn't that great? Thank you. I don't think it's against the rules to clap your hands. It's okay. But let's just, I want to encourage you guys that are at home and everybody that's here. I'm excited for the day that we can all be here. But right now it's kind of a hybrid of the two. But I want to encourage you guys to not just take this in like it's some sort of concert or something. But our attention up here and your attention out there should not be focused on each other. You guys shouldn't be focused on us. We should be focused on our Creator and on Jesus and on His presence because He's here with us this morning. Amen? Okay, I couldn't hear you through your masks. Okay? Amen? Okay, all right, let's keep singing. This moment for each individual, whether they're here or whether they're watching online, that cannot say that this morning, that doesn't have your peace, that doesn't have your rest, that doesn't have your joy, God, I just pray that you would just make yourself completely known to them in this moment, God, whether they're sitting at home in their living room or they're here this morning, God, that whatever they've been carrying, whatever burden that they've been trying to carry themselves, that they would be able to bring it to your feet and leave it at your feet and say, it is well with my soul. I have a peace that passes all understanding, and I have a joy in the midst of the struggle. have a rest in the busyness of life. God, forgive us for the times that we rush through church like it's some sort of program that we got to get over with and get on with our lives. You are love, and you bring light to you're feeling exhausted, let's just lift this up together and say, come, Lord Jesus, come. God, we know that your presence is around us. God, come in my heart, come in my life, come in every situation that I face. And we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. God, we need your presence. Oh, come, Lord Jesus, come. And we sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. We sing, come, Lord Jesus, come. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God, we thank you that you are good. Thank you that you are good. We thank you that you're a God who doesn't stay far off from us, but you draw close to us, God. The Lord bless you. Sing that again. The Lord bless you and keep you. It's just a benediction. It's a benediction that you say over somebody. You speak God's blessing over them. So right now, just take 5 seconds. And whether you want to ask God or whether you already have somebody in your mind, and at home you can do this too. Somebody in your mind that you want to sing this song over. And even if they never know you're singing it over them, let's just do that together. The Lord bless you and keep you and make his face shine upon you. Be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face towards you and give you peace. So think of somebody in your mind, and we're going to sing that over them this morning. And we're going to sing this over you guys here and you guys that are watching. And let's just sing the Lord's blessing over our city, over our family, over our country. The Lord bless you. favor be upon you and a thousand generations in your family, your children.
Everyone who's at home, I'm going to try something I've never tried before, which is this fancy mic here.
That's the Garth Brooks mic.
Yeah. Well, being that I'm white and chubby, I do have that in common with Garth. I just thank you so much for the worship this morning. It's just so good to sit in the presence of God, right? Yes, yes. I agree. I could just keep it going. But I do think that the Lord gave me a message to share with you today and with those of you who are online. And it's been confirmed, actually, twice this morning. First time was through some of the song choice, because, you see, I did not phone Jardith up and say, this is what I'm speaking on. And yet several of the songs were exactly about what I'm speaking on this morning. So I think before we start this morning, let's all bow our heads together, shall we? Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for being here with us, for just blessing us with your presence, God. I pray that that will continue throughout this sermon, Lord, as I share the thoughts that I had around this issue with you. And Lord, I just pray for each person here that you will just reach the need in their life, God. We all have them. And the people who are listening online or watching online as well, Father, you will just minister to them. There's only so much that we can do humanly speaking. We are your hands, we are your feet, we are your voice, Lord. But then your Holy Spirit just needs to come in and take over for us. Thank you so much. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you, guys. Thank you very much. When Pastor Lee asked me to speak again today, I told him that I wasn't sure if I could. I said, maybe I only have one sermon in me and I've already preached it. As I told you last time, I'm not a preacher. I am a teacher by profession and vocation, and I'm a mother by vocation. So Pastor Lee assured me, though, that God's word never returns to him void. I believe that. It accomplishes what God intends it to. And that's from Isaiah 55:11. So I've used lots of scripture today because I figure if you hear the scripture, it will do a work in your life. And then I've just put my words in around it. It seems that I've been spending a lot of time in storms this summer. Have any of the rest of you noticed that? It's been a lot. Like a week and a half to 2 weeks ago when we got dumped on, I hadn't seen so much water in our ditches in a long time. Years, in fact. My garden was soaked. Our chickens were in danger as they lay in pools of water. Everything was drenched. And that's just our physical surroundings. We're all in this storm of COVID. We are facing other storms as well in our lives. And emotionally, I feel I've been going through storm after storm in the past year and a half, starting with my dad's accident and sudden death in May of 2019. And frankly, for most of my life, there have been just storms, things happening that are beyond my control. Ever feel that way, that something's going on maybe right now that's beyond your control? Yeah, I thought so. So how many of the rest of you feel like you've been going through a storm? Do you feel pushed about by the wind, battered by the rain? I was visiting with a young lady last Sunday who's been facing storm after storm lately. I'm sure she's wondering when this is ever going to let up. When will the sunshine come out again? So I'm going to take you through a couple portions of scripture today in order to examine how Jesus handles storms. Let's start in Mark chapter 6, reading from the New Living Translation. The apostles returned to Jesus from their ministry tour and told him all that they had done and taught. Then Jesus said, "Let's go off by ourselves to a quiet place and rest a while." Now, this is a good idea. I hope that's what Pastor Lee and his wife and family are doing this Sunday. They've been working so hard through this whole COVID thing with their broadcasts several times a week. Notice that Jesus didn't say, "Let's go work ourselves to death." Even he needed to go rest a while. And it was God who invented the Sabbath rest, remember. Once every 7 days, we're supposed to take a break, step back. Stop working so hard for that day. It recharges you. Now back to scripture. Jesus said this because there were so many people coming and going that Jesus and his apostles didn't even have time to eat. Now how many of you have found yourself in that situation this week? Probably any mother who has more than one child, and even that one can get pretty, you know, you've got a bunch of toddlers around, and all of a sudden it's like 2 o'clock, and you're like, "Oh, I haven't even had dinner yet." So I'm sure some of you can relate to this. Verse 32, so they left by boat for a quiet place where they could be alone, but many people recognized them and saw them leaving, and people from many towns ran ahead along the shore and got there ahead of them. Jesus saw the huge crowd as he stepped from the boat, and he had compassion on them because they were like sheep without a shepherd. Notice that Jesus is very gracious about handling this change in plans. Are we good at handling changes in our plans? Examine your actions and your heart over this past week. How have you been when your spouse or your kid has interrupted you and messed something up and required you to change your plans? What about when your truck broke down and you were left without a cell phone? Whoops. Back to scripture. So Jesus began teaching them many things. Late in the afternoon, his disciples came to him and said, "This is a remote place and it's already getting late. Send the crowds away so they can go to the nearby farms and villages and buy something to eat." By the way, the guy with the broken down truck and the lost cell phone that is because his wife had carried it away accidentally in the car was extremely gracious. I just have to point that out. Never even yelled at her. But Jesus said, "You feed them." Uh-oh, there's another change in plans. With what, they said, we'd have to work for months to earn enough money to buy food for all these people. Thinking very literally that we're there, right? "How much bread do you have?" he asked. "Go and find it." They came back and reported, "We have 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish." Then Jesus told the disciples to have the people sit down in groups on the green grass. So they sat down in groups of 50 or 100. By the way, I am getting to the storm part, if you just hang in here with me. Jesus took the 5 loaves and 2 fish, looked up toward heaven, and blessed them. Then breaking the loaves into pieces, he kept giving the bread to the disciples so they could distribute it to the people. He also divided the fish for everyone to share. They all ate as much as they wanted, and afterward the disciples picked up 12 baskets of leftover bread and fish. A total of 5,000 men and their families were fed. Now Jesus really needed a break. He had wanted a break before. He didn't get it. He needs a break. Immediately after this, Jesus insisted that his disciples get back into the boat and head across the lake to Bethsaida while he sent the people home. After telling everyone goodbye, he went up into the hills by himself to pray. Alone at last. Late that night, the disciples were in their boat in the middle of the lake, and Jesus was alone on land. He saw that they were in serious trouble, rowing hard and struggling against the wind and waves. About 3 o'clock in the morning, Jesus came toward them, walking on the water. He intended to go past them, but when they saw him walking on the water, they cried out in terror, thinking he was a ghost. They were all terrified when they saw him. But Jesus spoke to them at once. "Don't be afraid," he said. "Take courage. I am here." Then he climbed into the boat and the wind stopped. They were totally amazed, but they still didn't understand the miracle of the loaves. Their hearts were too hard to take it in. Okay, I want to pause right here because we're always so hard on people in Scripture. We get all judgy, like if I was there, I would have done things differently. But we forget that they were so human. As each of us is. They had just seen Jesus feed over 5,000 people with only 5 loaves and 2 fish. Now, I was fishing this week with my family, and we brought home 5 fish. And they were a nice size. They were jacks. And my daughters did a fine job of filleting them. But those fish fed us for, well, they'll feed us for 2 meals. I've cooked 1 batch up already. There's 1 more batch in the freezer. We wouldn't come close to feeding 5,000. Even if those fish would have been over 10 pounds each, that's nothing amongst so many people. And yet Jesus stretched that meal to feed 5,000. It was clearly a miracle. Interesting then that the disciples seemed to view Jesus as a one-hit wonder. I teach kids who have special needs. There's a term that we often use with our students called generalization. So you take a skill and you try to teach a kid that skill. It might be a social skill. It might be another skill like wiping their nose. But the next step is to teach them to generalize that skill. So they can do this skill in this setting, like say go to Timmy's and pay for a coffee. But can you take them to McDonald's and they can still do it in that setting with a new set of people, new counter, that kind of thing, okay? That's called generalization. It seems that the disciples didn't think that Jesus could generalize. Okay, he did this miracle in this setting, but this situation over here? And we're getting all judgy again, right? So I want you to walk through this exercise with me. I want you to picture, each of you, in your own mind, a significant miracle that God has done for you in your life. An event where you can say unequivocally that God showed up. We all have them. A time when we prayed for our child and their fever went down. A time when we stepped off the curb without thinking and the car just missed us. Okay, maybe that's just me. Or I have 4 kids sitting here with me this morning. Each one of them is a miracle. I have a story about God, how God sustained them, how he kept them alive, how he brought them into our family. You all have stories. So think of that story. Hold it in your head right now. You fill in the blank when God showed up. And you can use salvation if you like, because surely that is the biggest miracle of all. That God would reach down and choose you. Yes, you. While you were still a sinner, Christ died for you, it says in Romans 5:8. But you can choose something else. Now, hold that thought in your mind, and I want you to place right alongside it The situation you are facing right now, you know the problem that has you up at night? The one that has your stomach tied up in knots? Now I want to ask you, do you think that Jesus is a one-hit wonder? Or do you think that God can generalize? Do you think that the God of the universe, who so wonderfully came through for you in this first situation, is big enough to help you in your current situation? I thought so. Now back to scriptures. After they had crossed the lake, they landed at Gennesaret. They brought the boat to shore and climbed out. The people recognized Jesus at once, and they ran throughout the whole area, carrying sick people on mats to wherever they heard he was. Wherever he went, in villages, cities, or the countryside, it was sick, sick, sick all the time. No, it says they brought the sick out to the marketplaces. They begged him to let the sick touch at least the fringe of his robe, and all who touched him were healed. Good thing that he had that little prayer break, because it looks like he won't be getting any more rest for a while. And it looks like he can generalize. Look at that. All kinds of miracles, all kinds of sick people healed. Okay, I'm going to take you to another gospel right now from the Gospel of Luke chapter 8. Another day, another storm. And while I'm starting to read this to you, I'm going to actually ask Veller to come and get ready to grab a mic. He has something he wants to share about this too. Let's start in verse 22 and see how Jesus handles this one. One day, Jesus said to his disciples, "Let's cross to the other side of the lake." So they got into a boat and started out. As they sailed across, Jesus settled down for a nap. But soon a fierce storm came down on the lake. The boat was filling with water, and they were in real danger. The disciples went and woke him up, shouting, "Master, Master, we're going to drown." When Jesus woke up, he rebuked the wind and the raging waves. Suddenly the storm stopped, and all was calm. Then he asked them, "Where is your faith?" The disciples were terrified and amazed. "Who is this man?" they asked each other. "When he gives a command, even the wind and waves obey him." Now this, I told you there were two confirmations of my message this morning. And after prayer time this morning, I hadn't told anybody what I was preaching on at all. They just knew I was preaching, and some of them barely knew my name. And that's fine, by the way. But it was so cool, because after we were done praying, Valor said, "Can I share something with you?" And so, Valor, if you could come forward, grab this mic, that mic, the handheld, and I'd like you to share, because it was just so powerful, and I thought it was such a confirmation for what I was going to preach on today, but I thought it came better from his lips than mine.
Yeah, very cool. It was definitely intended to be a personal, intimate word.
Sorry about that, Valor.
That's okay. Yeah, I just felt this morning, I thought maybe just for you, but mm-hmm. I guess in general, with this, I felt like the Lord really highlighted this these verses as well. And he doesn't say, "You have no faith." He says, "Where is your faith?" Meaning mm-hmm. they do have it. They just weren't reacting. And this was sort of one of those situations that I believe that the Lord was speaking, saying, like, it's strange that he corrected them for the disciples after the disciples turned to Jesus. Generally, we think when we turn to Jesus that that's actually, like, what we're supposed to be doing every time. And he's just like, "What are you doing turning to me? Like, I've taught you this. It's settled in your heart. Like, you know, like, I want to calm storms. You should have known. You don't have to ask me, should you calm the storm, Jesus? Can you calm this?" Mm-hmm. I have taught you enough to know that you can calm that storm now. And it just kind of blows my mind that he actually corrects them for turning to Jesus. Generally, we think that's what we're supposed to do. And he doesn't renew our mind all the time that Romans 12 talks about. And he doesn't teach us these things and generalize these teachings to us. He doesn't do that for us to still walk in unsureness. Mm-hmm. But he was just like, "Yeah, like I have taught you. You have seen my miracles. You should know it's more than one circumstance, but many. And I want you to step out in your confidence and in your discernment, knowing that my mind is now in your mind and that your mind is becoming my mind. and just trust that when a storm happens, that you don't have to turn to me and ask, like, Jesus, is it okay? Like, should I pray for this situation? Should I pray for this cancer? Should I pray for to feed these people? He's just like, yes. Don't ask me. It is always yes. That was
awesome.
Sort of,
you know. Thank you so much. I thought that was pretty amazing that God put that same exact portion of scripture on his heart and had him share that with us. Thank you so much. And I just wanted to highlight Jesus's calmness in contrast to the disciples' panic here. Why did they have such different responses? Well, have you ever been in a boat where there's fierce wind and waves? Yes, me too. I hear a yes. Once, actually twice, because I didn't learn my lesson the first time, when we were coming back across Chittick Lake, I found myself in this situation. The waves were terrible, higher than the sides of our boat. And I think Lloyd was having to bail water out of the back of the boat the one time. Our first kids were small, and I remember clutching the baby to my chest, just praying that we would make it safely across. And we did, obviously, because I'm here today. Well, anytime you're in a storm, the wind and the waves, the thunder and the lightning can be very intimidating. And the more you look at them, the scarier they seem. If you are trying to calm a small child in a storm, you might try a distraction, like soothing music or their favorite movie. You might sit with them and stroke their forehead and just talk calmly to them. Rarely do you take them out to the front porch and go, whoa, look at the size of that storm. Do you think that lightning's going to hit us? If we get a little closer to it, son, it just, you know, we don't do that. And so I think we need to look at that. Are we doing that with the storms in our life? Are we comparing the level of our storm on the Richter scale and going, well, this is a big one. And compared to the one I had in 72, this is a real big one. You know, and we need instead, I think, to place our focus on something else. And I think that's the difference between the disciples and Jesus' response in this passage. The disciples' focus was on the storm. And I mean, let's not undersell it. The danger was real. And some of you are facing real danger right now. For some of you, it's financial problems. You're in so deep, you don't know how you're going to dig your way out. And for some of you, it's relationships. There are things you need to deal with, maybe things you need to get rid of, maybe things you need to build and nurture. And you need to sort that out with God, and you need to fix it. And for some of you, I mean, the cancer is real. If you're going through that battle, my goodness. Of course, it is real, but be aware, God knows this, and he hears you, and like Valor said, think of the storms you've been through before. Think of God's faithfulness in those storms, and then turn those things over to him. I liked what Jarda said about laying it at his feet. You know, sometimes when I'm really stressed out, I like to picture in my mind just, I don't know, it's a bush. I think it's this little bush that the Holstein bull chased my dad around back on the farm. I don't know. It looks like that bush. And I just picture myself taking all those problems, bundling them up, and laying them. It's at the feet of Christ. It's just giving them to him and then walking away. So when you're in and you're thinking, God, this situation has me sick to the stomach. I can't eat. I'm in agony. I can't sleep. Now remember, Jesus says again, where is your faith? This is an invitation as well to change your focus, to turn your attention to the one who made the universe, who made the heavens and earth, who has protected you time and again, and who has gotten you out of countless scrapes. Turn your focus onto Christ. Spend time. How do you get to know Christ? How do you get to know God? Read his word. You need to be doing that daily. You need to be replenishing, refocusing yourself daily. Singing. I love the song that Mariah and Jared sang. I'm going to sing in the middle of the storm. It was a few months ago now. I think it was spring. And we were up at our cabin. And I think I've shared this before, but bear with me. I'll share it again because I think it applies. So we're up at our cabin. Lloyd and Dylan were in the garage. It had started to rain. I headed out for a half-mile walk.
So I'm walking around, and the dog came with me. I'm walking. All of a sudden, the dog takes off back towards the house, and so I turned around. Where is she going? Oh, the neighbor's dog has come over, and she's a black lab. Oh, my word, that's a bear. It was a little big to be a black lab. And here's a bear just come, and it's between me and the house. And I'm in the middle of the storm. The rain really starts up then. I'm like, what the hang am I going to do now? Well, luckily for me, I had actually been picking out worship songs for leading that Sunday. And so I was already singing. And I just kept singing louder and louder, just like they said. And, you know, I just sang and I prayed, God protect me, because, I mean, there was nothing I could do. I tried yelling, but Lloyd and them didn't hear me because the truck was on. And I just kept walking towards the house. I didn't know, has the bear just gone back behind the bush and he's ready to just grab me when I come by? Well, again, no, because here I am. So obviously I got through safely. But that was the middle of a storm, a big black bear. God got me safely through. Which begs a question. What's your storm today, or what is your big black bear? I want to close with a couple thoughts here. One, in John 16:33, Jesus says, in this world you will have trouble. You will have trouble. Somehow, in some sects of Christianity, they've got it wrong, and they will preach you will never have trouble, you will never have disease, you will never have this, you will never have that. No, Jesus says, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. So get to know him, read your word, spend time in prayer, and then spend time listening for the voice of God. And as you listen and as you follow what you feel God's telling you to do, just like today, when Pastor Lee said last week he wanted me to preach, I right away thought, well, I think I need to preach on storms, these passages. Started working on it. Halfway through the week, I thought, I've got this other sermon I could polish up over here. Maybe I'll change it. And then I thought, okay, try to discern. Which one does God want me to preach? Well, no, I think actually I'm hearing storms. But it wasn't until this morning, and I get here, and the music is about storms, and Valor comes to me with a word about storms, that I know for sure, yeah, I did hear from God. And so then I'll be a little more confident next time when I hear from God that, okay, yeah, this is what I think God's telling me to do. I'm going to pursue that. And I want to finish by reading a Psalm of David. This too is a song, by the way, but I don't know the tune, so I won't sing it to you. David was described as a man after God's own heart. And one of the reasons, I believe, is that he didn't just spend time learning about God, going to church on the Sabbath, and then going off and doing what he wanted. He spent time worshiping, spending time with God daily, getting to know him personally. He is a real God. We can get to know him. In Psalm 34, David says, I will praise the Lord at all times. I will constantly speak his praises. I will boast only in the Lord. Let all who are helpless take heart. If you're feeling helpless today, let all who are helpless take heart. Come, let us tell of the Lord's greatness. Let us exalt his name together. I prayed to the Lord and he answered me. He freed me from all my fears. I want to speak that over you today. He freed you from all your fears. Those who look to him for help will be radiant with joy. No shadow of shame will darken their faces. In my desperation, I prayed, and the Lord listened. He saved me from all my troubles. For the angel of the Lord is a guard. He surrounds and defends all who fear him. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, the joys of those who take refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you, his godly people. For those who fear him will have all they need. Even strong young lions sometimes go hungry. But those who trust in the Lord will lack no good thing. Come, my children, and listen to me, and I will teach you to fear the Lord. Does anyone want to live a life that is long and prosperous? Then keep your tongue from speaking evil and your lips from telling lies. Turn away from evil and do good. Search for peace and work to maintain it. I was talking to somebody this morning, about marriage, and sometimes it is work, right? Work to maintain it. Search for peace and work to maintain it. The eyes of the Lord watch over those who do right. His ears are open to their cries for help. But the Lord turns his face against those who do evil. He will erase their memory from the earth. The Lord hears his people when they call to him for help. He rescues them from all their troubles. I love this part. The Lord is close to the brokenhearted. He rescues those whose spirits are crushed. For anyone, and you'll know this, is your heart broken this morning? The Lord is close to you, and he will rescue you. The righteous person faces many troubles, but the Lord comes to the rescue each time, for the Lord protects the bones of the righteous. Not one of them is broken. Calamity will surely destroy the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be punished. But the Lord will redeem those who serve him. No one who takes refuge in him will be condemned. Years ago, when our second son died, a friend, he was just a distant kind of friend, but he showed up at my in-laws and he brought a picture. It was a painting of, and you've probably seen this painting, it was the hand, it represents the hand of God. And nestled in the hand of God is just this little child, just at peace. And he wanted to give that to us to comfort us at that time. But when he dropped it off, he gave it to my father-in-law. And what he didn't know is that my father-in-law was going through a deep, deep depression at that time. And when he got that picture, it just spoke to him. And he thought that the person was actually dropping it off for him. And so I didn't correct his misconception. I let him think it was for him because it just spoke so much to him. And then later he found out about the mix-up and he felt bad. And I said, no, Dad, it's good. You needed this. God provided this at a time when you needed a tangible comfort for yourself. And I said, someday I'll need that picture and I'll take it back from you. And when he passed, I took the picture and I hung it on my wall in our guest bedroom downstairs at our Glenbush house. And that's what that picture is. That's who we are. We are nestled in God's hand. And when you look at what David wrote here, you might assume that he's writing this with a golden pen on his fancy throne after he'd been established as King of England, or King of Israel, I mean, not England. But he didn't. He wrote these while he was hiding from Saul in the land of the Philistines, who were actually Israel's enemy. And he was having to pretend that he was insane so that the king wouldn't wonder, why is he hiding out in my land? And maybe I better investigate and arrest him and turn him over to Saul. So he was having to pretend that he was crazy. It was a very stormy time in his life. He was one step ahead of Saul all the time, him and his band of merry men. And yet, he fixes his focus on God here. So that's what I want to encourage you to do. I don't know what your storm is right now, but I know you have them because I have them. I have storms in my life. I'm preaching to myself right now because I'm having to turn these over. But I really appreciate also what Valor said. There's a scripture about not being tossed about with every wind of doctrine, not being tossed about, I think, with every storm that comes into our life. I would love to get to the point where when these storms come in, I kind of look and go, huh, another storm. Okay, and just turn around and continue doing what I was doing. I want to reach that point in my Christian life. I'm not there yet. But I praise God that he can get me there. He says, in this world, you will have trouble. But be not dismayed. Take heart, it says in this translation. I have overcome the world. So let's pray together. Heavenly Father, I just pray that you will take my clumsy words and help them speak to someone's heart, to provide a salve, Lord, to those who are hurting, to provide strength to those who need it. Use your scripture, God. Help them to delve into your scripture this week. Help them to spend the time worshiping you and getting their thoughts and their minds on you, and everything else will fall away, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just pray that you will help each person who's listening, who hears this message, minister to them, Lord. And until we meet again, thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you. Have a good day.